Using the latest creative tools inside of Adobe Aero, I created 4 immersive augmented reality riddles where you explore an AR landscape while learning about your brain. Welcome to the 4th and final part of the 4-part tutorial series, where I break down all the key components to my brain-splorations. In this tutorial, I will show you 3 things: how to paint and export textures in Adobe Substance Painter, how to use the orbit and weight triggers, and finally, how to animate a flying character path or a motion path in general. Let's get started. All right, so here is one of our brain characters that we painted for Adobe Aero experiences, and I'm gonna show you how to paint a model inside of Adobe Substance Painter, and then how to export those textures in a nice format that works for Adobe Aero. I'm gonna go ahead and open up Adobe Substance Painter, and we're gonna close out this welcome screen. And I'm gonna start off by going to the top left corner and choosing File, and going to New. And we gotta change some stuff. First thing I like to recommend is change this template to the Adobe Dimension template. It will be really nice for your textures later, so I just recommend it. For the file, we gotta load up our 3D model. So here is mine, it's this brain character. I'm gonna hit Open. And for the document resolution, that's how large the textures are gonna export at. And I highly recommend 1024 because that is the highest resolution that you can currently safely bring into Adobe Substance. Into Adobe Aero. So I highly recommend you use that format for your resolution to be the highest quality it can be. A couple things. If you have never heard of what an unwrap is, or you don't know what UVs are, or UV mapping, you might want to turn this check mark on. This will automatically unwrap your model if it doesn't have a UV coordinate set up. That sounds really complicated. Just basically, if you don't know what it is, just check it. It will unwrap your model for you. And with all these things set up, I'm going to hit OK. And on the left side is the 3D model. On the right side is the UV coordinates. And the way that we can paint in here is you can grab a material from the shelf and drag it onto the model. So I'm just dragging this nice gold material, and it already looks really cool. But since this is for the last experience, we want to make them green. So I'm going to go to that base color and switch it to a nice green color and make it a little bit deeper green. Awesome. Looking good. Next, I'm going to, I want to paint his arms and legs a slightly different color. So I'm going to right-click in here and add a new, go up here and click on the fill brush and just fill it with a brand new color. We can change that base color to something else. So I might just switch it to a beige like I was using earlier. Okay. And then what we do is we right click and we add a black mask. And then now wherever we paint is going to receive that color, and it will hide everything else. And this is much like Photoshop at this point, where you can just paint your model with your mouse or your stylus. And you can just see your 3D model getting painted. So we've roughly painted the arms and legs of the character. And we can now change that color around so I can make it more of a green color to kind of blend back into things, or lighten it or darken it, etc. And then to map out the part of the brain at the last experiences, I'm going to add another fill color. So I'm going to do I'm going to click on the fill brush and just paint bucket tool and fill it all. And then right click, create a black mask. And then I'm going to paint on that part of the brain. And if I want to draw more attention to it, I can change the color. So maybe I'll just switch it to a bright color somewhere else. Something like that ought to be good. And there we have it. We have our model painted. And this little mess up on the foot there, I can erase that. So let me just grab the eraser and just kind of clean up some of that part of the foot. Okay, awesome. So great, we have our model painted. And there's 2 other steps I like to do before you export it out. I like to go to the Edit and choose Bake Mesh Maps, and then hit Bake Mesh Maps. And this kind of remembers all the texture and edges and stuff, and kind of makes it look a little bit more realistic. I kind of like the dual colored here in the legs and stuff. And so we'll just leave that on. And the last thing we do is export our textures so that they can work nicely. So we can go to File and choose Export Textures. And because we used that Adobe Dimension preset earlier, I'll show you what it did. It's going to export all these different textures, a base color, the roughness, the metallic, the opacity, the glow, and the normal matte. So it's a bunch of different channels. Each of these would be one 1024 by 1024 pixel image. So this might be a little bit heavier. If you know you don't have a certain channel, you can just uncheck them because I have nothing that really needs to glow. And I think I'll leave everything out. Oh, there's no opacity. I'll take that off. So I just want to have these four materials come out. And I can see what the PNGs are going to be. And then you want to make sure you choose the spot to save them. So in the settings here, under global settings, I'm going to change the path to be the one from earlier. And I'm going to create a new folder. This is for the tutorial. And select that folder and choose export. Awesome. So that just exports all of our textures, which is really wonderful. And I'll show you what they look like here. And if I just double click on these, you can see we have our base color, we have our metallic matte, we have a normal map, and we have a roughness. Looks like there's nothing in my normal map, so I'm actually not going to use it just to save space and decrease the load times. So we just have these three channels that are really needed. So I might as well just delete that normal map because we don't really need it here. So we have these three. And then now that you have your textures and you have your model, we're pretty much done. I like to kind of just apply my textures again to my model inside of Adobe Dimension. So I open up Dimension here, and we're going to click on Create New. And I'm going to split the screen here. I'll split it with my texture outputs. And I'm going to drag that model in here. You can also right-click on an object and tell it to align to the floor with that single click there. It's a really nice button. All right, here is our character. And it looks like it applied all the textures already because I can see it really nicely in here. And so my last step would be to click on this button and, select on your object and then click on the upload button. And we can choose the export selected models or export selected for Aero, which is what we want to do. And it says, cool, it's ready for Aero. I hit export. And then I just need to save this to a spot where I can access my monster later. Great. And so now that is ready to go. It should be up into Adobe Aero, ready for us to play with. All right, so to bring that model in, we're going to hit that plus sign and go to our Creative Cloud. I'm going to navigate to my Adobe Aero folder, my Adobe Dimension tests, and choose my brain character tutorial and hit open. And then we can tap to place it and tap to rotate it and scale it up. And now we have our character in our scene. Pretty cool, huh? All right, so take a look at this scene. Lots of cool stuff is going on. But one thing that's really nice is this text that says find the riddle is always orbiting our middle character here. So I'm gonna show you how you can make objects orbit each other inside of Adobe Aero. So I click on the edit to start. And let's say we wanted to do it with a brand new object. So I'm gonna hit the plus sign and go to our starter assets. And this is where I used the boxes here. So if I go to basic shapes and scroll down, we have the wooden cube. And I can tap that wooden cube to place it. And let's say we wanted this wooden cube to orbit around another object. So all we need to know is the name of it. So this one's called wooden cube number 10. And this one's called wooden cube number 1. So if I want to get this one to orbit, we're going to click on it, tap on behaviors, and go to the triggers. And I want this to happen right away on the start. So on the start, I want an action to happen. Here are a bunch of the actions that work right now. And we can add an orbit action. Now if I hit play, it's going to orbit the camera, which is what we're viewing from right now. That's because the subject is correct, right? The wooden cube number 10. But the camera is set as the center. So I'm going to change that to the wooden cube 1. Then hit play. Now you can see that it orbits around that cube. Pretty cool. If we scroll down here, we have the ability to change the duration. So you can scroll it to the left or right if you want to be really quick. Oops, I'm going to go back to my orbit. Hit play. or we can type in our own value if that's not enough time. So maybe we need 10 seconds or something. And I can hit play, and you can see the same idea. It's gonna go around the object. All right, so another really cool thing that we did in this experience was added an animated motion path that we made inside of Adobe Aero. So if you were to click on this cube here, it would make this other cube appear, and notice how it kind of follows around and moves up and down and passes by, and it goes up and it swirls around all over the place. This is using the path move, and I'll show you how you can make your own. So to make your own path move, we're gonna start off and hit the edit button, and we're gonna have it happen to a new object. So I'm gonna click on that plus sign and create a new starter asset and choose the basic shapes. Let's do it with this golden pyramid. Great, so you got this golden pyramid here. And what we can do is tap on it and choose behaviors and add a trigger. And I'm gonna create a trigger on the tap. When I tap this gold pyramid, I want the action to happen. And the one that you want is the third one from the top right now. It's the path move. Now, if you hit play, nothing's gonna happen because we haven't animated the path. We have to click on the create new animation button here. So I click on it and notice at the bottom it says it's fixed to ground. So what happens is if we hold on to this object for 3 seconds, we can draw a path with our fingers and the object is going to follow that path. And I'm just gonna release it right there. And then if we wanna preview it, we hit that play button at the bottom and you can see the path that we just drew with my finger. Now I'm gonna hit the pause. If you make a mistake, don't worry, you can always go to the upper left corner here and hit the retake button. Now it's ignored that and we can do another one. So I can hold it down for 3 seconds and create a new path and hit play to take a look at that path. Cool. So I'm gonna hit the retake one more time and show you one more button to address. At the very bottom here, you can check off fixed to ground. When I do that, we now can hold on to our object and make a path that is going up and around, and we can lift it up and we can move our device up and down. And now we can create all this really cool motion that's taking advantage of the Z and the X and the Y plane. Now when I hit the play button, you can see that it goes through and kind of just animates through. I'm just sliding through the timeline here. Let's say I like this one, I'm gonna hit save. And when I wanna play it back smoothly, I hit the play button here. And now I can see that path that we had just made. Pretty cool, huh? There's these three lines over here. If you click on them, you have different options. We can have it behave as a car, as a plane, or as a helicopter. They all are just slightly different ways of moving. So I'm gonna choose plane, and I'm gonna grab onto it for 3 seconds. And now you can see that it kind of follows and orients itself along the path a little bit better. All right, and then I can switch it around. Let's try helicopter. And I'm gonna hold onto it for 3 seconds. Let me hit retake. Hold down on it for 3 seconds. And now you can see that it's not really changing its orientation. It's just moving along the path like a helicopter would. So you got all these different motion paths that you can use. So we have this object moving now, and I wanna show you how you can use the weight trigger. So if I tap on it, it starts to move and start to do some cool stuff, right? Pretty cool, pretty fast. I'm gonna hit the edit button. Now if we wanted to do another action after it completes that, we can add a weight behavior. So after it hits tap, it's gonna move our path from earlier. If I click on the action now, I want it to wait. So I'm gonna choose the wait at the bottom here. It looks like a little timer. And then I can have it wait a few seconds, maybe wait about 2.5 seconds. And after it waits, I'm gonna choose one more action. I want it to hide. That way it can just kind of vanish. So now if we did all this correct, a tap to a path move, to a wait, to a hide, we can hit preview at the top corner here. Tap on our object. And we're watching it kind of follow along its path. And then it's gonna land, it's gonna wait for 2 seconds, and then it should hide. And there you have it. That's how you can use the weight trigger inside of Adobe Aero. Thank you so much for watching part 4 of 4 of the making of the immersive AR riddles. Adobe Aero is both friendly and yet feature rich. So if you haven't watched tutorials 1 through 3, I highly recommend them, especially if you wanna start creating an Aero today. My name is Don Allen Stevenson III, and I hope you have a creative and productive day. Thanks for watching.